everybody, I'm Vega from Ultimate Cuddlebug, and this is Scott Swain from clearsay.net, and he is going to be teaching a nonviolent communication course in the Dallas area in early November. So I thought it'd be fun to ask Scott a couple of questions. Would you mind telling us a little bit more about what nonviolent communication is to you?
Okay, yeah. For me, it is a tool to increase empathy. I believe there are many tools out there that we can use to get better at putting ourselves in other people's shoes. And I think that NVC is my favorite.
Okay, so why nonviolent communication? Why not another tool out there?
Why do I prefer it? Because it has integrity and scalability, and sustainability. I feel like it is more than a tool. I also see it as a way of stripping away the layers of programming that our culture has given us because of parenting, media, all these ways.
So how do you use nonviolent communication on a day-to-day basis?
Stealing sandwiches?
My favorite way, too.
Yeah, because if you can manipulate people, then you can get them to give
cashiers,
you all kinds of
just
free
so
stuff.
Gullible. No, but really, really.
Well, I like that I am more likely to see from another person's perspective, to be curious, rather than to be thinking, as I'm talking to somebody, how does that relate to me? What can I get out of this? What have I done that's like that? What do I like or not like? And so I think before NVC, I would have those thoughts a lot in conversations. A lot of judgment that was a moral judgment and a value judgment. It's like this person expressing something they've done, I found myself comparing myself to them and judging them and thinking about ways to help them or change them or get them to do what I want to do. All of that to me is not useful, is not even efficient, especially if my goal in life is to enjoy myself and enjoy other people, and made it easier for me to not be in that mindset. So to put it positively, it's made it easier for me to be in a mindset of curiosity about a person and just really seeing things from their perspective. And that, it's a lot easier that way too, because I don't feel this responsibility. I don't feel like, I've got to be trying to change this person or help them or fix them or whatever. Instead, I'm in this kind of listening that's very peaceful and doesn't have an agenda. So it's a lot easier.
So it sounds like it really takes the nonviolent communication really takes the pressure off of you in day-to-day conversations that you have with people.
Mm-hmm. And in conflict, it is especially useful, because I would rather than, the typical way is to attack or defend. And if somebody is seeming to attack me, it's much more useful to not see it as an attack, to instead see what it really is. Like, there's a need that this person is not getting met, and it might be for respect, it might be for safety, it might be for connection, who knows. But whatever their need is, to recognize that rather than, oh, that bad person is attacking me, so I'm going to attack them back, or I'm going to be defensive and, like, plead, innocence or whatever. But how about with NVC instead? Hey, wow, you're hurting, or you're really angry right now because your need for blah, blah, blah was not met. To me, that is a lot more efficient and less likely to damage a relationship and more likely to get to the bottom, to really understand what's going on.
So why do you think empathy is so powerful?
Because it takes us there. For one thing, it takes us to a place that we may never have visited, which is a deeper part of people that we hide, that I think we're taught too often. We are taught as children to hide this part of ourselves that we have a need, you know, that, you know, if you have a need for touch, you know, how often do you feel comfortable expressing a need for touch? You know, what people can you express that need around? It's a very limited, in our culture, it's a very limited number of people. It's like certain family members and or lover and or really, really close friend. Or, you know, I would rather that we feel like we can express all of these needs to anybody optimally. I think that's what evolution will bring.
Cool. Thank you. So how would you like to see nonviolent communication used more in the world today?
Many ways. In business, in politics, in parenting. I think in parenting might be one of the most important ways. But they all come together. They all influence each other. You know, if people are using it, say, in their business, which is, I think, something that's the world is ripe for, is more empathy in business. But yeah, if somebody's using it there, they may see the value in it and then take that home and use it with their children, which is where, again, I think that's super important. I think raising children in this way of, and it doesn't have to be nonviolent communication, but it's something where we are at least recognizing a child's needs. So if a child is crying and they're hurting, instead of just addressing that pain and trying to get rid of that pain as soon as you can with some kind of distraction or reward or punishment, and thus teaching them all kinds of things about, like, stuffing their mouths for, you know, because, oh, yeah, I'm feeling lonely, so I'm going to just, like, eat like a pig or whatever, okay? Buy a bunch of stuff. But instead of that, what if parents would be like, oh, you're crying, you're hurting. Let's talk about the reason why you're hurting. So some kind of need not getting met. What is that need? And let's say the need is power, because, you know, power has been demonized. But in NVC, we make a distinction that there's power with and there's power over. And we encourage power with. And power over having probably obvious connotations. But power with, I mean, imagine your typical child who is, they're controlled, they're overpowered from the moment they're woken up in the morning by somebody and dressed and moved around throughout the day until they're put to bed and or told when it is time to go to bed. So we are surprised when a child has a tantrum, when they are expressing a desire to have some power over their environment. But what if a parent, not permissive parenting, but what if a parent found that middle ground between permissive parenting and authoritarian parenting? What if they found this thing and they called it peaceful parenting? And it is where the child will experience consequences for the things they do. Yet they're not demonized. Yet they are listened to in this way that's so much deeper. It's like, what are your needs? Let's really listen to those needs. And hearing those needs, recognizing them, like, oh, you have a need to play right now. And that's not getting met because we're doing something else. Well, just to recognize the need, to me, is so much more than not to recognize it. And does not mean we have to fulfill the need. It does not mean, oh, we're going to give our kid every single thing they ask for. No. Those are strategies to meet needs. And when we go down to that needs level, we will find so many more strategies to deal with the things that are happening every day right now. And that's not getting met because we're doing something else. Well, just to recognize the need, to me, is so much more than not to recognize it. And does not mean we have to fulfill the need. It does not mean, oh, we're going to give our kid every single thing they ask for. No. Those are strategies to meet needs. And when we go down to that needs level, we will find so many more strategies to deal with the things that are happening every day and get diverse needs met. Then, so we have politics, we have these parties, and we have this bickering between parties. We have this demonizing where somebody, you know, I think of them as teams. And it's like, my team is better than your team. And so your team, all the people that are part of your team are kind of stupid or you know, they don't do the right things, but we do, or we care in better ways than your team does. So you're bad guys and we're good guys, you know, and you got that thing going on. And they're competing for the most votes and the most power, so that they can pass the laws to control. and to me, and then elect a person who is seen as not just a leader, but a ruler. And I make a distinction between leaders and rulers, where leaders are voluntarily followed. So a leader can issue an order, and those who are following this leader can say, sorry, I'm not going to follow that. I'm going to leave. And to me, an example is the business world. In the business world, we have leaders, not rulers. Because rulers, it is involuntary that you must follow them. You must follow the rules they create, i.e. the laws. But in business, there are no laws within a business. There are just rules. And you can choose to break those rules, and maybe you will lose your job, or maybe you will be demoted, or whatever. But you always have the freedom to not go into work, to leave that company. So I make that distinction, and to me that coincides with, in nonviolent communication, demand and request. So in the world of rulers, we demand, or it is a demand. You know, it is a demand that you follow the speed limit. It is not a choice. And NVC is all about choices, because we feel that when you force something, you force somebody to do something, you will pay eventually for that. Somebody will pay. Where if both parties agree, then it is a mutually consensual.
So a lot of the times in politics, you have governing bodies that get together to talk about maybe an issue that they're having. And one of the values that you've talked about before that I've heard is that you're able to see the needs of both parties, and that it would make it easier to negotiate when both parties can come to the table and say, I see your need, and here's mine.
Yes. Thank you. Yes. Yeah, that's important. So in the political world, where we have these teams, these parties, these nations, these disputes that seem to be never-ending, I believe using a tool like nonviolent communication, or just having a populace, or having people, politicians, leaders, rulers, whatever, with this tool of, as a form of communication, negotiation, whatever, response to differing ways would be more likely to be an empathetic response. So for example, hey, we don't like what your nation is doing, then instead of, we're going to drop bombs on you, how about we talk about it? Because see, we're seeing it as you're just different. You have differing values. We're not going to demonize you. No, we're not. There is no, you are wrong and bad. It's more like you're doing these things to serve your needs. And there's a conflict here. There's some things that some needs we have. But because we're looking at things at the need level, we can see so many strategies that overlap. We could find so many more ways, things that we can do that serve your needs and mine. So we're always looking in NVC for, okay, wait, how can we get everybody's needs met rather than this compromise thing, which means somebody loses. Mm-hmm. Compromise means somebody is not getting their needs met. But wait a minute, why settle for that when we could look for ways where we all get our needs met?
So when you understand the needs underlying a situation, you can use different strategies. Because ultimately, when you have parties that come together and they're trying to meet needs, it's the strategy that they're arguing about. And we don't recognize what the need is that we're trying to serve underlying them, which is ultimately where conflict can come from. Because we know we have a need, it's just hard to articulate it. Mm-hmm. And so by being able to use the language of that nonviolent communication offers, you can come up with a strategy. Cool. Is there anything else you want to say about NVC?
Well, I believe every person that wants to learn it can get the book Nonviolent Communication by Marshall Rosenberg. Mm-hmm. And that to me is, even though book reading kind of a thing that people
don't really, last century.
Yeah. I think it's very useful to read the book.
Really worthwhile read.
There's an audio version. The book is actually pretty short and easy, kind of fun read, I thought. And but yeah, there's lots of videos out there on YouTube of Marshall Rosenberg and others. It's spreading, yay. And I really believe that each person using it, any little bit, helps to spread it, and we ultimately are helping ourselves by creating a more peaceful world, creating a world where people are more likely to really listen to each other and to really see each other as partners, versus enemies or competitors.
So I'm curious, when you first started doing NVC, did you have any aha moments? Mm-hmm. Like any, or any that you'd be willing to share?
Yeah, thank you for asking that. Yeah, I mean, it was really exciting. In fact, so exciting that I wanted to share it with everybody instantly. You know, I wanted everybody to know this. And then also it made it hard at times to hear conversations and hear, it was more obvious the shaming, guilting, blaming that happens in so many conversations on subtle levels and on obvious levels. And I really wanted to just, sometimes I wanted to grab people and shake them and say, wow, you don't have to be doing this to each other. You can be, you know, getting along. You can be really revealing what's inside you. And you can really be hearing the other person and understanding what's inside them, and instead of fighting. There's that. And then it slowed me down some, because I would more often think about what I'm going to say more in depth before saying it. And
it's a process. It's a rewiring of your brain. So it takes a lot of practice and a lot of time to become fluid with it. Mm-hmm. So it takes a lot of patience and empathy with yourself when you first start doing nonviolent communication.
Yes. I probably sounded really kind of stupid at times, or weird, you know, like you're like, what do you mean?
So that's an aha moment when you sounded stupid and weird.
Sure. Yeah. Yeah, and so getting fluent with it, and even just having the courage to use it when I know it doesn't sound normal. You know, people don't walk around saying, oh, are you afraid because you have a need for security that's not getting met? You know, that's kind of a clinical NVC way of speaking. After a while, you get used to it, and you incorporate it, and it sounds more authentic, you know, because people will... It will sound to people like in the beginning that you're not being authentic because you're being so planning with the way you're speaking.
So like with any good tool, it takes practice to learn how to use it.
Yep.
So you should come to the workshop or check out some other stuff that's online. When you meet with people in person, especially someone who's as skilled and knowledgeable as Scott is with nonviolent communication, it's really awesome because you get to put it to use with real people and you get to practice with people. And I think that's one of the biggest differences and benefits of doing nonviolent communication with people, is you actually get to be like, hey, this is the situation in my life. Here's what I've thought of, maybe getting some other input. Or if you've never used nonviolent communication before, figuring out how someone who uses this tool
gets free sandwiches. Frame it.
And free sandwiches. Shh, it's our little secret. Cool. Well, thanks for watching, and hope we'll see you later.
Bye.